Good day, fellow investors. Today's Sunday stock analysis is Callaway Golf. It is a leader in its niche, which is golf clubs and golf balls, and there are some other developments which make the company interesting. So let's dig into the sector, the company, the fundamentals, the risk reward to see at which price it is a good investment and whether now it is a good investment. Let's start. Callaway Golf is a stock that has surged 153% in the last 5 years. And is a great example of what this market is all about. More about that at the end. So the company manufactures and sells golf clubs and golf balls in addition to golf and lifestyle apparel and accessories under the Callaway Golf, Odyssey, OGIO and Travis Mathew brands worldwide. The most sales come from the US, 54%, 90% comes from Japan and the rest from across the globe. The company boasts a 12% annual growth in market share, which is something remarkable, but we have to see where does it come from. Fundamentals show stability up to 2017 when there was revenue growth, margin improvement and more cash from operations. The most important question investors want to know now, will the growth continue or is the story about to end, become more risky because then investors would be in trouble? Let's first look at the fundamentals. The price to earnings ratio is a bit high now, 35, with the forward consensus price to earnings ratio of 25. Price to book is 2.41 and the dividend yield is 0.23%. Very, very low dividend yield. Let's look at the key ratios page that will tell us a little bit more about the company. So the key to understand a company like Callaway is that it is cyclical and that people usually play golf when things go well in their lives. Its revenue is still below 2007 levels and just in the last few years have its margin reached the previous levels. Net income was higher in 2008 at $66 million than it is now, 10 years later. Something also very important to note is that the number of shares outstanding went from 64 million to 97 million, where the book value went from $9 to the current 7. What is positive about the company is that it has no long-term debt, but it has increased its short-term asset-based credit facility to $97 million from $11 million. Inventories jumped 38% thanks to an acquisition, while intangible assets in 2016 went from $88 million to $225 million. The increase in intangible assets comes from $75 million OGIO acquisition and the $125 million Travis Mathew acquisitions in 2017. The company Travis Mathew that they acquired for $125 million had sales of $55 million in 2017. So the company now got some cash and they started acquiring other companies. And this is typical of Wall Street. Wall Street wants one thing. They want constant, everlasting growth. And the management, the poor managements, want to please the analysts that lead to investors that push the stock price higher. What they start doing? They start doing stupid acquisitions. They think everything is going good, we are great management, we turned around the company, and then they spent $200 million, which is what, 3-4 times the yearly earnings on acquiring two brands that the owner wanted to get rid of, because the owner of those brands developed those brands and now it's selling them. And that is the first risk I see with Callaway. What will happen to those brands and will those brands add to the earnings over the long term? That's the main question, given the cyclicality Callaway has shown also in 2007. So, dilution 50%, there has been plenty of shareholder value destruction. And what does the management decide to do now that the stock price has more than doubled over the past 5 years? Now that they have cash, make acquisitions, they decide to increase the buyback to further destroy shareholder value because now they buy back shares at double the book value instead of buying them 2, 3, 4 years ago when the stock price was much, much lower. Buybacks went from $5 million in 2016 to $17 million in 2017. Nevertheless, the management sees its key growth drivers in the new driver that they developed and in the increasing beginner numbers of golf players. However, I look at the up chart here on the right and I see a declining number of total golf players. So the sector is in a structural decline. Nevertheless, there are some good things. Top Golf, the trendy golfing clubs the company owns, is just a small part of the company, but they sold 10% of what they owned for $23 million in 2016. And this is something I don't understand. If it is such a great business, why would they sell something in 2016? And then, even worse, in 2017, they invested $20 million back into the company in an investment round by Fidelity. So the company had a stake in Top Golf, then sold part of a stake for $23 million, $17 million gain. You pay taxes on those gains. And a year later, they put back $20 million into the company. So why did they do that? In, out, of course, that's something behind the wall that we cannot see that's happening with Top Golf, but we don't know whether the company is profitable. The company is hugely expanding, so that's always a risk, but also a potential reward. Let's see. The company is expanding very fastly. You can see on their Instagram how there is building all around the states. And those are, okay, they have to buy a lot of land or lease the land, build a nice platform. That's costly to operate, and that's very trendy now. However, the question is, with the declining golf numbers, whether these clubs will be still interesting over the next few years. I'm always looking at long term. I always include a recession in what I do. So those are the risks. Other rewards are the dollar is getting weaker, which means 46% global reach, that those profits will be much higher in dollar amounts. Another question is, okay, if the company continues to grow, if the company continues to acquire those small players, even if the they are overpaying, nevertheless, if they can continue to acquire those, implement in their selling lines and improve the margins, then it might be even further growth for Callaway ahead. So that's a positive reward. Again, we are talking about a market leader with 23% market share in Europe, in Japan, and in the US. So very, very strong market leader, and Nike and Adidas have exited the production of golf clubs and golf balls in 2016, I think. So that was a good for Callaway, and they really are taking advantage of what's going on. Back to Top Golf, I didn't mention that the current value of Top Golf, estimated by the company, the fairly value is $290 million or about $3 per share. So you can see how to go about that, whether that is something fairly valued or overvalued. Let's look at the risks. And this is something that I find very, very risky, because I see the company pursuing the growth imposed by Wall Street. In the last earning calls, the management increased its credit facility to $360 million, and that's something I don't like, as they have made two big acquisitions in 2017, and they are planning on making more acquisition, and this time using a loan. So $225 million of intangibles. I would not add even more loans before I see how these acquisitions work out. But it seems that they are really pursuing growth. On the valuation side, top guidance for 2018 without non-recurring costs, which are always there every year, leads to a price-to-earnings ratio of 23.4. Any kind of costs in that year would keep the price-earnings ratio to 30. This implies an earnings yield of 3.3% for a company that didn't actually grow over the last 10 years and is in a declining sector. In case of a recession, in case of write-offs, in case of things not going as planned, and whenever you see those synergies, those integrations of other brands, things never go as planned. And in this market where everything is overvalued, in order to buy something, you have to overpay for it. There is no other. So the upside, the reward is about a return of 3-4%. If they grow earnings, it will become 5%, but they can't grow much more than they have been growing in the past. So 3-5%. And in case of a recession, we fall down to book value. If we impair another $3 of the intangibles, then we fall from 7 to 4. Top Golf is their value if we add that up, which is not on the book value because they account it at cost. They will have to account it at a fair value this year, so that might be a change. So we might see book value at 10, impairments, not impairments, let's see. It will be fluctuated because of the Top Golf stake that they have. So let's say downside from 10 to 5. So for me, 4-5% return over the long term against a 50-60% downside is not the risk reward that I like. So to conclude, back to the typical market, the typical representation of the market, chasing growth at any cost. And that's something that is very risky, that scares me, but that's the short-term mindset that most investors have, unfortunately analysts and Wall Street, and that leads to great companies like Callaway, great niche company, leader, market leader, doing stupid things that might turn out very bad in the long term, as it has been the case in 2007. History is repeating again. Thank you for watching. Looking forward to your comments. Do you have any other niche companies that are market leaders that you want me to take a look at, or at least put on my list? You never know when will a new analysis come out. See you in the next video.